Welcome to Songs of Praise on Advent Sunday, when for many, the preparations for Christmas truly begin. Now tomorrow, up and down the country, children will open the first window on their Advent calendar. It's a very exciting time. But how many children know what Advent really means?
Also on today...
I'm in Luton, where a Church of England vicar has found a bond with the Roma community here through their mutual faith.
I meet a man who's creating a fresh fusion of reggae and worship music.
And the descendants of World War I soldiers discover remarkable details about the 1914 Christmas truce.
My grandfather said no shoot on Christmas.
And there's singing from the church in Ypres, built as a memorial to those killed in the war. And the BBC Philharmonic accompany the Huddersfield Choral Society.
Today is also a special day for Scots everywhere, as it's St Andrew's Day. So let's begin at Paisley Abbey with a hymn written by John Bell, sung to a traditional Scottish melody. Southend-on-Sea, things are looking pretty festive and the Christmas shopping bonanza is really gathering steam. But with all this commercialism around, I'm wondering if the message behind the Nativity story is being lost. But here at Barons Court Primary, like many schools up and down the country, the message of the Christmas story is being upheld.
Well, the story of Nativity is when Jesus was born.
An angel tells Joseph that they're going to have a baby.
So they have to travel a long way to Bethlehem.
They went by a donkey.
There was no room in the inn, so they had to go into a stable.
I like the bit when the baby gets born.
And an angel told the shepherds about it.
Fairies. No. Angels.
The lambs came because the shepherds have lambs.
Three wise men give gifts like jewels and money.
Jesus is special because he's part of God.
It's like It means love and joy.
The message might be clear to children, but in a recent survey, it seems many adults aren't as convinced.
51% of people were saying that Jesus had no relevance to their Christmas. But we've seen that it's starting to change. There's kind of like an atmosphere that people are understanding more about the story, about what it can mean for them nowadays as well.
And that's partly down to a recent campaign.
The campaign, it's called Christmas Starts with Christ, and hopefully everyone will see this logo around on bus stops, on billboards, wherever they are this Christmas, they'll see this message that Christmas starts with Christ.
So what's the point?
It's to get the church to come out of the building and into the high street. For example, we're setting up in a moment in the high street a nativity scene. Now, just not any normal nativity scene, but one where people can get involved and play those characters.
And you can find out how we get on creating Bethlehem in Southend later on in the show. But now, a wonderful Advent hymn from the Royal Garrison Church in Aldershot. Christmas 1914 and the Great War is in its infancy, but already 2 million soldiers have been killed, wounded, or gone missing. Yet exactly 100 Christmases ago, the most extraordinary acts of peace and goodwill broke out across the Western Front.
I have ordered my people that no shot is to be fired by our side today, Christmas Eve, and on Christmas Day if it can be avoided.
On both sides, some men kept diaries which reveal how the truce unfolded.
The German shouts to wish us Merry Christmas and tells us they are not going to fire tonight, nor tomorrow if we don't.
Over the next 3 weeks, we're taking the relatives of two servicemen who kept diaries of the truce, one British, one German, back to Ypres in Belgium, where peace suddenly broke out.
William was, he was a batsman for one of the senior captains.
Louise and Luke Tapp are the great-grandchildren of Private William Tapp, who served in the Royal Warwickshire Regiment. They're travelling to Belgium with Morgan, who's Louise's son.
Can you spot which one William is? How can you tell?
His moustache.
How old would you say he is?
30.
Spot on.
Spot on. We're really looking forward to taking Morgan to the place of the Christmas truce, and for him to see where our great-grandfather served.
I'm really curious about like how they survived in these conditions.
The actual diary William wrote is now kept at the Royal Regiment of Fusiliers Museum, Warwickshire. And before heading to Belgium, Louise and Morgan want to see it for themselves.
Look at the handwriting of it, Morgan. They've got this truce. And so this is a really unusual event, and your relative was part of this, and he wrote it down.
It's amazing to just be sat in front of this diary. It's just to know that it's survived 100 years. It does make me feel closer to him.
Our stretcher bearers are going around carol singing. They sing several in our trench before going. The Germans give them a cheer for singing. It doesn't seem right to be killing each other at Christmas time.
Meanwhile, just 100 yards away across the trenches, Lieutenant Kurt Zemisch was writing a diary.
After a few words about the birth of Christ and the Holy Night, he sings a carol, Silent Night, Holy Night.
He's schon ganz eingetrocknet worden.
Kurt Zemisch was one of the main instigators of the entire truce. But his son and granddaughter, Rudolf and Anna Rose, had no idea until they discovered his diary in an attic in East Germany just 15 years ago.
We didn't know that this the diaries of the First World War because it is written in shorthand. After we translate this shorthand, we know that it's the Christmas truce in 1940. For me, it was very important to read that my grandfather said no shoot on Christmas.
Now Anna Rose is making the trip to Belgium to see where it all took place and to meet the Tapp family, who are also making the pilgrimage to Ypres.
We're really looking forward to meeting Anna Rose. I think it'll be a really special occasion. You know, fate brought them together 100 years ago, and then the same thing's happening with us, to meet Anna Rose.
It will be very interesting for me to meet another family that have the same information about the Christmas truce.
Next week, we'll follow both families' arrival in Ypres and learn more about what their relatives did a century ago.